Okay, do we have any minutes?
Yes.
You have some.
Right there in the corner.
Okay.
John, there's another set for John.
Did I get a set?
Oh, yeah, there was a set here.
Yeah, there was a set when you came in and sat down.
Okay, all right.
Could be buried or stuck in the book with the other.
I don't stuff things in my book.
Okay, you have the minutes.
It includes the meeting with the selectmen.
I'm sorry?
It includes the meeting of the, with the selectmen, continues. You'll notice I did not put in budget review, I just put it in the minutes. When we just, is that the one we just found a second to?
I'm sorry?
I was thinking out loud. No, this is a different meeting. We've had so many meetings last, didn't we? No, this is fine.
The wastewater treatment plant, I thought I had the salaries.
I thought you brought it back in.
Having been approved or recommended.
You had, but remember, I had made that error on Kevin's salary. So it made a $500 difference in what you had voted versus what if.
Right. But you brought it in.
Okay.
Yeah.
Then the one operator.
It turned out the operator was fine. What that was that operator is new, and the salary that was in there
was
higher because the old, that was the old salary.
Okay, well, we didn't vote.
Well, actually, you're talking about wastewater treatment plant?
Yeah.
We think there must have been a mistake in the budget last year.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because that is the same guy that was there last year, but I don't know where that number came from, but we did recalculate the current proposal, and it's correct.
So we can revote that.
Well, you still have one operator.
What's the number?
Had reduction in pay.
That's the one. That's the one she's talking about.
What's your account number? Please.
Account number is 422-5110.
I thought you were talking about wastewater treatment plant.
No, wastewater treatment plant dash salaries, no account number.
Today.
Sorry.
Are we talking about highway department or wastewater?
Wastewater.
Yeah, it's on, it should be in your tab 12 if you put it in your book.
Yeah. New one today. I didn't get a new one today.
You checked your box?
Yeah, I got everything in my box.
It was last week.
Yeah, it would have been handed out to you last week.
It was handed out again
last
week.
Or the week before? Last week? No, it's last week.
Last week.
422-5110?
No.
Salaries.
There's no number. It just says WWP.
PP salaries.
P salaries.
You got it today?
What do you have for numbers? Just so that we're all.
So as a total for the wastewater treatment plant salaries?
Yes.
I have 252,665.
Yeah,
okay.
That's what I have also.
And that should be on your summary sheet too. I just wanted to confirm that, be sure.
Mm-hmm. So, we want to discuss that or?
We're still in the minutes.
Pardon? Yep.
We're still in the minutes,
okay.
Yeah, it's showing, on the summary sheet, it's showing a dollar less, 252,664. And that's fine.
We'll have to stop the meeting then and have that correct.
Special town meeting.
All right.
I make a motion to accept the minutes of March 22nd?
Second.
Moved, seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
I abstain, I wasn't here.
Gotcha.
So it's 6-0-1?
Yes.
Since we have the wastewater treatment plant salary budget, why don't we go ahead and take that up and...
I make a motion, we revise the approved amount to $252,665.
$252,665.
Second.
Open discussion?
Yep.
I should have brought this up at the last meeting, but Kevin's increase is only like $500.
Well, that's just one-sixth.
No, I know, I realize that, but 500 there, and then at one-sixth, it's $575 increase in total wages.
Well, if you...
But it's the salary, it's the compensation schedule that drives that number.
Correct.
So the question is he in the right step?
Yeah, I think so, because...
That only gives him five, I mean, people receiving $3,000 increases.
That's one-sixth of that. So you multiply six times the $500, he's getting $3,000.
Okay. I wouldn't be the one, sorry. Thank you.
Sure.
Can I withdraw my motion?
What's that?
Can I withdraw my motion?
What's your motion?
To approve it. Approve the revised. Can we start again?
Okay.
Because I don't like the raises, 4 or 5%.
So we don't have a motion at this point. If somebody make a motion, so we can discuss it.
I'll make a motion to accept the wastewater treatment plant salaries funding for $252,665.
Is there a second?
Second.
Go ahead, John.
I'm against it.
Okay. You don't want to discuss it?
No.
Okay.
It's up under discussion now.
I just think the, I go back to that wage schedule, I think some of the people were getting 4 or 5% increases.
Yep, I agree.
And I can't go along with that, whether it's a wage schedule or not. So I'm opposed to it for that reason.
They shouldn't be getting that much of an increase if they went to the right step.
It's the way it worked out in the new comp plan.
I know.
It was the best that we could do without penalizing them for going to the new comp plan. The whole idea behind the new comp plan was to bring people up to speed, and so I could go back and look at my details, but that was where, you know, Wendy and Skip and I thought they belonged.
And I understand what people are saying, but we already have approved other salary budgets at the new pay scale. So it's...
And I disagree with those, too.
Right, but we've already voted and approved those.
Some John voted against.
Right, yeah.
Because when we figured it all out, John said no.
Yep.
We have a... We have a motion, a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
Opposed.
Extentions? So that's 6-1-0. Tomorrow night, Kevin's going to be at the joint, I'll call it joint meeting, Finance Committee and Selectmen, and he will be discussing his budget, highway budget.
Okay.
So just to let you know, we're not going to...
Highway or something, wastewater?
It's the waste...
It'd be the wastewater.
Wastewater, excuse me, wastewater budget.
Wastewater expenses.
Expenses.
Right, yeah.
So you're going to hold off on approving that?
Going to hold off on that. Unless there's questions that people, there were two or three items in there that...
It was all the increases.
Yes, so Kevin's...
Sure why, so...
Kevin's going to talk about this.
Good.
And ultimately, it's up to the selectmen if they want that budget, and we can either recommend it or not.
Yep.
But I figured it'd be worth waiting until... Okay, let me put this away. Wastewater treatment plant, what's the account number?
It doesn't have an account number because it's a special article.
But someplace you do have an account number for, right?
Well, wastewater treatment is Fund 610. It's a whole fund.
Okay. I thought we could spend some time tonight going over the South County EMS budget, and then when we meet with the selectmen, we can discuss that with them tomorrow. Zach is here tonight, so if we have questions, I'm going to guess that he's willing to give us answers.
Can I butt in?
Sure.
I just received today from Zach some capital requests. One was a different amount for the cot loaders, and then there was a request for improvements to the building. Is that right?
There's this one here, I think.
Yeah.
That's the new one.
Yeah, they were on that.
Yeah.
Okay, but two of them are new to the Capital Improvement Planning Committee. One's new amount, one's brand new. So they haven't been approved by the Capital Improvement Planning Committee. With that being said, since it's not being appropriated with a special article or any article, it doesn't have to be approved by CIPC, because the bylaws say we only look at stuff that's going to be appropriated.
No, Finance Committee bylaw says we can...
No, I'm talking about capital improvement planning, not finance.
So
what... I'm speaking about what the... So they have yet to be approved by the Capital Improvement Planning Committee, but yes, we don't really have to.
Well, so, I assume you're meeting tomorrow night, right?
Yeah.
I would hope. Are you going to take these up then?
I don't know. Let's see if we have time.
Okay.
I don't know what else we're going to be hit with. I think there might be that building between the library and the old senior center may have to be discussed. I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know. Like, it's a surprise to me. Tonight, so.
If we could. I don't have a problem with that.
With what?
We can discuss them.
We can get some.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm not saying we can't. I'm just making you aware.
Yeah, I understand. Thank you.
And Zach apologized.
Brenda, did we get a detail of the expenditures for skin?
You got that at the meeting last week. Skip wanted them quickly because I had just gotten done with the warrant.
He didn't make copies.
Can I have those?
He didn't give us.
Yeah.
So I handed those all out last week.
So,
well, does everybody have?
Not this. We have for the all of them. We don't just have South County EMS.
Right. Okay, this one's just South County EMS.
So I'm not sure I understand what you're talking about now.
Their breakdown.
Did we get?
The cost breakdown, the expenditure breakdown, South County EMS. I think you gave it, you put it.
Well, I gave the detail to Skip, and he put it together on a spreadsheet that he handed out to everybody. Is that what you were asking for, Mary?
Yes.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Did we get it? Not from you.
No, what, I'll be more than willing to Xerox these if you want, or.
Oh, yeah, those, he took the details and put them onto the spreadsheet that he gave you.
And I, that, the spreadsheet that I passed out.
And then you passed it out.
When did you pass it out?
Which one? The one you said.
Today?
The one you asked about too.
Oh, just today.
Today.
Oh, today, yeah, I'm with you.
I have marked it today. Okay.
Sorry, I thought you were referring to the expenditures for the entire general fund, which were handed out last week.
Right, no.
So I apologize that I got that, got you mixed up there.
You can have those.
Can I?
Yeah.
Make your copy.
Well, no, those, we all have copies.
Oh, you do? Okay.
Yeah, we do.
So at the top are the revenues. And I took 215, FY215, FY216. And for FY217, that's the, through the month of March, i.e. 19, give or take, 19 warrants out of the 26 typically we have. So total revenues for FY17 do not include anything after March 30 or March 23rd actually. So that's why it only shows 875,000. The projected revenues, and those are going to be somewhat suspect. So you see the FY 2017 projected, and then beside it is the FY 17 2000 budgeted. And the those are the budget items, except for the miscellaneous revenues and the reimbursements and the projected medical service fees. To arrive at the projected medical service fees, what I did was I took the $415,000, divided it by 19, and multiplied it by 26. Now, for a budget that everything happens evenly,
that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
So, but it's not necessarily going to happen right. That evenly. But I'm going to guess that it's fairly close. Zach, what do you think? Give or take? Close?
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. We always try to budget a little bit conservatively on the billing revenues just because.
Oh, yeah.
Medical. I have no idea. Until the year closes out, I have no idea what that number is going to be.
So the budgeted amount was $410,000. And give or take, there's $150,000 potentially in excess. And I have no objection to budgeting conservatively there. Deerfield assessments, Sunderland Whiteley assessments, retained earnings, that's the amount that is being used out of the retained earnings to fund the budget. And I think, how did that break down? What was the philosophy behind the $345,000?
For FY17?
Yes.
That was the ambulance.
I think it was just to get the reserves down to a.
Yeah, I mean, there's a portion of that 345. There was a portion that had already been appropriated for like capital stuff that we expected to roll over that we put back into capital and things like that. So,
$285,000 for the ambulance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think the rest of it was just for operating expenses.
That's
correct.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. That sounds right.
Yeah.
I don't know if I have a cheat sheet here.
60 operating.
And part of this, you know, we're hoping that with this FY18 budget to solve a lot of that confusion with those retained earnings to make sure that we have those accounts set up and those line items for like the operating reserves, just so in the future, we're not looking at that number and then trying to recall, you know, what portion was what, yeah.
But you, the only reason they even brought it up is that it was something I vaguely remember saying that we're gonna use some of this for, to reduce the assessments and.
We did. We did last year reduce the assessments. So it had to come out of retained earnings, and it, $60,000 wasn't enough to reduce retained earnings. If you use $285,000 for the ambulance and $60,000 to reduce the assessments, it was more, I'm pretty sure it was more than $60,000.
$60,075 maybe?
Is that what it was?
$62,075.
So that's all we used to reduce the assessments last year. So they went down minimally? Only $60,000 from last year?
The assessments went down 19%.
Right. Last year.
For FY17, yeah.
Right, not $60,000.
Oh, some of it's because of the operating budget might have been reduced.
We're talking about retained earnings. That's what they could have used.
No, but you're talking about the assessment.
As far as retained earnings, what I can tell you is if you look at the bottom line for FY15 and 16, those two numbers there, $502,000, $358,000, those are accurate. So you could add those together, and that would have been the retained earnings as of the time that DOR certified them. So it would be 860.
Yep.
Actually, DOR certified that amount less the $345,074. So the amount that they certified was $517,405.
Yeah, you can't add those together because a portion of the retained earnings from 16 are going to include some of the retained earnings from 15.
They carry over.
Yeah, exactly. So you can't just add them together. Yeah, 517.
So 517 at the end of what was.
We do know that the retained earnings at the end of the year, or the surplus, whatever you want to call it,
sure,
for 2015 was $502,000. Yep. The surplus, the amount that was left unspent for 2016, was $358,000.
No.
Yes. Yes.
6/30/16 was $517,000.
No. Earnings. That I said surplus. I didn't say retained earnings.
That's just for that.
That's
year's
the surplus.
Surplus.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the amount that would tend to go to retained earnings.
That's correct.
And the $345,000 that I have plugged into FY17 from retained earnings. Actually, they're taking that out of the FY16, 15, whatever. So it's the point is that. Well,
there's $285,000 out of the $314,000, and there's $60,000 unaccounted for.
So if you take those two numbers, subtract the $345,000 over here.
Right, and you get $517,000.
And what's sitting in retained earnings right now is $517,000.
Then we just need to know how that's spent.
And you'll see the third sheet of the South County EMS. I gave you their operating budget, then I gave you their capital, and then right behind that shows how they intend to spend that $517,405.
Yeah, it shows.
So they're basically intending to spend all of the retained earnings that they had at the end of fiscal year 16.
So that was the 110 plus 110? Are you saying the third sheet?
It is the third sheet.
Okay, one, two.
It's a landscape sheet.
It should look like this.
I didn't get it either.
Yeah,
it was behind your South County EMS capital budget.
I'm with you now.
Okay. You got it.
Tiny.
On that, Zach, I'm just curious. Mm-hmm. The stretcher load systems, two of them. We had originally talked a price of $20,000, And we have it listed here at 50,000.
Yeah, you want to talk about a hair-pulling moment when I was double-checking all my numbers the other day. I found that, I'm not sure what happened. It was absolutely my fault. I think what happened was the initial capital request was before we got the official quote, and I heard the $20,000 amount and didn't realize that that was a verbal quote for one. Going back and double-checking all of my numbers this week, I found the actual quote from the company, and it's like 24 and change per unit. So two units to get installed, and the upgrades for the stretchers. So the final quote in writing from the supplier is $49,500, something like that. So that was a total gap on my part, and that was the submission to try to give a more appropriate number that I dropped on John's lap today. Yeah, my apologies about that.
So this 517 is using up 1516.
Correct.
And what's not in using part of 16 that was appropriated but not used.
Correct. Yeah, there's a little asterisk in there.
$51,000, which should have been used by the ambulance.
Well, so the way it was set up was part of the operating budget instead of actually as a reserve.
Okay.
So because it was part of the operating budget, it rolled right into retained earnings.
Perfect.
Yeah.
In the facility outfitting?
Yeah, so that's with in anticipation of receiving the gift of the building.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so that's covering furniture and so on and so forth?
And that's anything that's not nailed or bolted to the building. So that's furniture, that's rugs, that's drapes, that's potentially the exhaust mitigation system, that's the security or the access controls, you know, like all of those things, air compressor for the bay, things like that, so.
Can I go back to the ambulance replacement fund? If we have $51,000 we can put into it for this year, annual allotment or appropriation into that account is 57. Why are we doubling it this year? Are we going to try to put an ambulance online earlier?
That 51,000 was the money appropriated in FY16.
Understood.
Yeah, and so we paid for the new ambulance out of retained earnings and the money that had been appropriated before FY16. So that number has already been appropriated for the ambulance replacement fund and was lost to retained earnings because there wasn't that separate fund.
I understand, but why are we doubling up this year? It seemed like the 18 budget would only be $6,000.
No, well the 18, the money putting into the reserve fund this year is 57,000, which is our annual fund.
And holding back 51.
No, we need to account for that 51 we've already appropriated that was lost into retained earnings because it was in the operating.
So where does the 51 end up in the 18 budget?
It'll be set aside in a reserve. I have to find out from DOR how to make that happen. But
okay, but if it's an ambulance, it has to be used for an ambulance. There's no reason to double the amount of the allotment for an annual assessment. An annual set aside for an ambulance is 57,000. There's no reason to put 108,000 in there.
I think he's trying to make up for lost time. I don't know.
The thing is, after we put 57,000 in this year, in that fund should be 108,000 because there should have been that fund previously. That previous 51,000 went into as well. So we're trying to.
I mean, it was money put in 17 that hasn't been spent, right? Or has that been spent on the ambulance?
No, that was spent this year for the replacement ambulance.
So there's $0 in the ambulance fund right now.
Right, and there should have been 51 from 16.
Yeah, but you spent retained earnings.
I see. So he's saying that the amount that was in there for 16 was really in retained earnings that got spent this year on the new ambulance is what he's exactly. What the way he's viewing it.
So there really should not be $108,000 unless you go skip next year.
This is the second year towards the next new ambulance.
So
yeah,
you're saying
17 and 18.
So you're saying the next new ambulance needs to be purchased in what year. So, so I think they have a specific year that they need to replace that ambulance, right? So you're trying to.
Five years, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21.
What are you proposing to? How often are you gonna replace?
It's every 5 years.
Every 5 years.
Because you have money on hand, though, we purchased an ambulance a year early, right?
Right.
So what's gonna happen now is you just moved up the entire schedule for replacement by a whole nother year, is technically what you've done. And that's why you're seeing the cost here.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Right.
It's good.
I mean, to wit, I would argue the purpose of a 5-year replacement plan is so our frontline ambulance is never older than 5 years. And in order to get to that point, we would have to bump things up if we have the opportunity.
When do you expect to get the new ambulance that I guess is ordered by the looks of it?
This next month?
This month, April.
Yeah, April 25th, I think, is the delivery date for the next ambulance. Is there, yeah.
This April, April 2017?
Yeah, so less than a month.
And how long did it take to make?
6 months.
So we're gonna buy an ambulance in 5 years from 17. 17, 18, 19. In 2020, we're gonna order another ambulance.
I can't say for certain when that's gonna happen. I mean, that's
gonna be. We don't have enough money at that point.
Right. So, I mean, the idea is that we're putting in 1/5 every year. And so every 5 years, that's the schedule we want to be on.
But I'm saying it in 2020, you're going to have an extra $51,000.
So let me see if I can. So you're saying 1/5 or 50-something thousand, whatever.
Sure.
57,000. So 2015, there should have been 57,000. 2016, 57,000. 2017, 57,000. And for the next 2 or 3 years, but this $285,000 that we're spending for the ambulance we're getting now is excluded from that. Otherwise we would you'd be 17, 15, 16, 17, 18, and 19 before you replace the first one. And that's not what we're doing. We got one coming in now.
They moved the schedule ahead by a year because they had too much money. And that's the reason they wanted to move it ahead.
But I don't think.
And they needed it anyway, so it's not a problem to get it going.
Right.
But now that you've got it going, we should stick with the 5-year schedule.
Right. Well, our next youngest ambulance is our next oldest ambulance, I should say, is a 2008, which means that if our goal is never to have anything longer than 10 years old, we're already behind the eight ball trying to replace it. I guess the reason it's accounted that way is because we had appropriated money in FY16 for that ambulance replacement fund that wasn't spent in 17 because it hadn't been
certified yet.
And so we bought the new ambulance out of the retained earnings that we had available so we could accelerate that replacement for the monthly new ambulance.
So the idea here is you're going to convince the community that we're just since we've accelerated the first one, we're going to put double the money in this year. That's pretty much what we're doing. We're playing catch up. I mean, you can't. Even because it wasn't certified, you actually spent what would have been the allotment for that year. Whatever allotment was made, just because it wasn't in the right fund, you spent because it wasn't retained earnings, buying the new ambulance. So right now, because we bought it a year early, now you're playing catch up to buy the next one a year early.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see why we need to put it underneath. I think the 51 is whatever could be. If it, the result is that DOR says you can't put it in that fund now. It's retained earnings.
You can
reserve anything aside that you want. It's as long as you're using certified retained earnings.
We could if you're talking about setting up a capital or ambulance fund, is there any reason that we couldn't appropriate the money from retained earnings?
That's what we're doing.
Directly to the
Well, what you do is you set up a reserve, you just, you take it out of retained earnings and put it in a reserve.
So in two fiscal years, 17 and 18, we'll now have $165,000 in the ambulance.
Be a year earlier, right?
And then two more years.
We have 17 unspent, $57,000.
Nope, no, because in 17, we purchased a new ambulance. We didn't put any money aside for a new ambulance in 17. We just purchased a new ambulance.
So on the capital sheet shows zero for ambulance in 17?
It should show 285.
It does.
17 shows 285, that's what we spent, plus it would have been something else?
Well, 285 is what was budgeted.
245 is what it actually shows.
245 was for the vehicle and the chassis. The $40,000 was for the medical equipment.
I know, but we only have in this line item 17. Okay. The medical equipment is of the other 40. I mean, I don't understand. 285 is the total.
Correct.
And that's the, so medical equipment inside the ambulance.
Yeah. Like those items that can be removed from that ambulance. And, okay.
So there was no additional 51. So you're, what you're correct. Doing with this 51 is replacing 17. And you're appropriating 18.
Right. That makes sense.
Also, on the original proposal, there is a trade-in value of 15 for the old ambulance. Did that happen or no?
No, it turned out to be a trade-in value of 5,000 based on the wear and tear on that vehicle and the year of it. The 15.
Did that happen?
Yes. That will be. That was part of our.
So it was 290.
Okay.
It was $290,000 for the ambulance?
Yeah, I forget what the final tally, yeah.
Okay.
I think we came in a little bit under budget on that, but like only by like, but only by like a few thousand, so I don't have that number right.
A few thousand less than 285 or a few thousand less than 290?
A few thousand less than 290.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So that money will just end up retaining in next year.
Correct.
I'm
satisfied with that explanation.
The ambulance that's being replaced is the two thousand.
Yep, former Waitley ambulance.
Okay. The new ambulance that's coming in. Well, let me ask the question: where's the Waitley ambulance registered right now? In what town?
Waitley.
And the Sunderland ambulance.
Still in Sunderland. Those haven't been transferred yet.
Where is the new one going to be registered?
Town of Deerfield.
Okay. I would like to see the Sunderland, so-called Sunderland ambulance. Not because I care what it, but because it is the town of Deerfield's liability.
Right. Oh, yeah. No, absolutely.
So that's 100%. Where I'm driving.
Yeah, that was something that was discovered recently and is in the process of making sure that those get transferred over appropriately as they should have been.
Because I have no idea what the insurance coverage on those vehicles, and I don't know whether you do or not either.
Okay, so we go back to the budget?
Yeah. Okay. Well, sort of. So they're ambulances. So
are we in the SCEMS, the enterprise fund right now? Or are we just doing discussion?
Yeah, we're just doing discussion.
We're discussing in the two pages still?
Yeah, yeah. This is just to pull the stuff together so you can see it.
Yeah.
And rather than Xeroxing
all those
60 pages.
Well, thank you very much.
Yep.
One of the ones that caught my eye is the vehicle repairs. In 2015, $22,700, in 2016, $15,000, and so far in 2017, $19,000. I'm going to guess that, with the exception of a few hundred bucks, those are all the Navistar. The number first ambulance.
Well, the International certainly has cost us some money recently. Yeah. I wouldn't say it's within a few hundred dollars. I mean, I think that the former Sunderland truck that Turbo went on that, you know, that's like $7,000 with labor and stuff like that. I'd have to pull out the specific warrants and see the breakdown for which truck. It's certainly that Navistar's been expensive, and we're excited to take it off of regular duty.
I'm wondering if any consideration's been given to maybe that one being the next one that goes, just to get it.
Yes, there's certainly been discussions about that, also about what position it'll take in our running order, whether it'll even fit in the Waitley station, and those considerations. It's certainly, we try to exercise the trucks in a way to play to their strengths, and that International may be the next one to go, depending on the situation, for sure.
Alternately, I know this has been discussed before, but you know, I think everybody has said no, it doesn't really make a lot of sense, but I just bring it up for discussion. Any possibility of keeping the box that's on that and replacing the chassis? Any idea what that would cost?
It's certainly an option. We weren't able to explore it with the Waitley truck just because the box was physically so old.
Yeah.
But certainly that box on that International is of a quality, and it's metal construction, aluminum construction.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely something that we consider. It's the chassis that really ages.
Yes.
If there isn't, you know, any sort of safety concerns, but that there wouldn't be with that truck.
And since that box, well, the box is 6 or 7 years old at this point, I'm not...
Right, and there's nothing about that box safety-wise, you know, that there's nothing, no recalls or nothing that it isn't capable of.
Yeah. What, any rough idea of what the cost is for a chassis and then to transfer it?
I forget what we paid for the chassis for the latest one.
I don't know. We have a cost in there of $66,000, but I think that was more than just the chassis.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, this is still far away, so I can't even begin to guess what that would be. Certainly less than everything new.
Okay. But I guess the thought was, you know, if we replace the chassis and could do it for something reasonable, I don't consider $150,000 necessarily reasonable, but... something significantly less than that,
mm-hmm.
put the number there. It would be worth considering, and if we did it within a short period of time, rather than wait 5 years.
Right.
Or rather than wait to lift double another $25,000.
Sure, right.
That chassis. Okay.
I was just wondering, Zach, have you had a chance to review what's get prepared?
The
reason I'm asking is I just wonder if he looks like he's done this projection, which I believe you've looked at also, and is with your budget.
Yeah.
You know, if you get some of these wide variances, have you increased those line items and decreased the others?
Yeah, well, I think you'll see.
Without checking everyone since we just got it, I'm just wondering if you've had a chance to look at it relative to your budget.
Yeah, I mean, the same thing that Skip did with his numbers, I've been doing every year. Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, we've been trying to tweak up and down.
Yep.
Yeah, absolutely.
It seems like recertifications, $6,000 over budget this year. And other payroll costs are over, almost $9,000 over budget. But that might be a combined item, too.
Recertifications,
projected budget,
No, I think we're still a little. I think we're still under on recertifications, right?
Well, if you look, it's on the second page, and it's one that's on my list to ask a question about. 2015, we spent $445. 2016, yeah. $300. So far this year, $125. We budgeted $6,250.
Right, that's what I mean.
So there's a big swing there. Mm-hmm. So again, that was on my list of
and other payroll costs, I believe, in the same way.
The other payroll cost, payroll cost, if you go back to 2015, and in some cases 2016, we spent way under, so it's
yeah,
it really is difficult to look at those.
Yeah, and the other payroll costs also include things like the indirect cost for the town of Deerfield line item and things like that, so.
Did that increase this year?
It did, yeah. I think by like $7,000, that was, Brenda recalculated that. There was also, that other payroll costs kind of turned into a catch-all our first year or two while we started seeing something, so we've been trying to like migrate those to different. Anyways.
Is the billing gone up so high because of the new software and so forth?
No, billing's gone up because revenue's gone up. So they collect a percentage.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I can't. Does that sound right?
Well, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
What's health and fitness?
Health and fitness breaks down to a few things. One would be new hires, fitness for duty tests, things like that, pre-employment tests. It also includes any sort of like TB testing, inoculations, things like that that we pay back to. We buy the serums and the town nurse administers those tests, but we pay for those serums. And then any other sort of like AEIOU, urgent care, anything that comes out of job employment stuff.
So you didn't do it in the past?
If I can, if you look, we spent $74 in health and fitness in 15, nothing in 16, so far nothing this year. So, but by the sound of it, there's something someplace. Where are those expenses?
Yeah, they're in another bucket somewhere.
What bucket are they in? Because we did budget $4,000.
Payroll costs.
Well, I mean, it's possible.
Yeah, I mean, I'd have to double check.
So I guess it's one of those things that, you know, I'd like you to take a look at, and either that or if we're not spending it,
yeah, right. Right.
Yeah.
I mean, medical supplies. We've already spent the pretty much the budget, and we were over last year, so. And that's one where I can see that, and I don't know what you budgeted this coming year.
I think that's, we just budgeted $13,000, so just $1,000 more than last year. That's hard to pin down. You know, there are times where I think we had to replace a whole stock of medication this year because the whole lot expired. You know, it's a 3-year shelf life, so we bought it for 14, now in 17 it came due. So sometimes those prices fluctuate a little bit more than I can really feel confident projecting long-term right now. That's still stuff we're trying to drill down and plan out further.
Can you explain liability insurance?
Yeah, I'm wondering that too.
So that, where is that? Did we?
I can probably speak to that.
Yeah, please. That's.
So the liability insurance is obviously lumped in with all of the insurance for the town. And I asked Maya to break that out as best as they could, and they said it's so embedded that there was just that small portion that they could break out that was actually specifically South County EMS. The rest of it is in the town's budget.
Now what is it that's cut? What do we cover it with liability insurance? Whether
I don't know just that I can't speak to.
What's it based on? Is it a flat rate or is it based on? Is it based on payroll? Is it based on taxes?
Well, I know.
Or a flat rate?
Professional liability is pretty well. I mean, if that's what we're talking about, general liability insurance.
Yeah, which one is this? Good question. Yeah.
But I'm sure it's not. We probably have a combination of both. Professional liability is going to cover you for any issues that you might have. And general liability is.
Which really begs the question, do we have any liability coverage.
Sure, I don't think we do if we go into $200.
Well, yeah, and even if it's mixed in someplace in the town, it doesn't sound like.
I mean, I understand they can't break it out, but maybe we apportion it relative to the number of staff people, or, and I know it wouldn't be equal that way, but if we have X amount of dollars in liability insurance, we have 30 employees, and Zach has seven, 30 could be applied.
I'm not sure how Maya breaks that out. They've got, you know, this, a number of different.
Okay, they might not even break out liability insurance.
I don't know. I'm trying to remember.
Who has the policy for the liability insurance? Who has the policy?
The town.
Town Deerfield.
Town Deerfield, yep.
Who has the physical policy? Do you have it?
No, that's in the selectmen's office.
There you go.
I just pay the bills.
Give her 5 minutes, and she's gonna tell us all about liability, right?
There it is.
Well, that's why I wanna see. Is it like a $500,000 policy, million, a $5 million floater?
You have to look through it. Go ahead.
Multiple policies. We have umbrella, we have a general.
Doesn't seem.
If we budgeted $4,000 and we only spent $16,000, the numbers just don't look right. Now, Carolyn's supposed to be the expert on insurance, because she used to sell insurance, and she's on the insurance subcommittee, so that should be a point of conversation tomorrow, like, how much are we spending for insurance for the town, and how much are we spending for?
Fiscal rep for SCEMS also, so.
Okay, I'll alert her that.
That's one of those things that we.
Tell her that we're coming.
Yeah.
I don't go to SCEMS, so I don't know the discussion that's happening. I just don't.
Forget the minutes we know.
I also thought the vehicle insurance was pretty darn reasonable.
Yeah, that's only.
$645 for one vehicle?
Yeah.
I spent $500 for my van.
Yeah.
That's only one vehicle.
So that's nothing.
Well, typically.
I did see that on a spreadsheet where they actually showed the vehicle, and that was the exact amount that they charged for it.
Typically, there's liability insurance in there someplace, and most.
Most vehicle insurance has liability.
So do we have enough, and can we raise that? I mean, it's a.
We did get recommendations for raising more general kinds of comments. We can look at that. Share that with the committee if it wants to get into.
As well as the $1,725, you're gonna have a brand new vehicle in there besides.
You're gonna have two others.
Well, yeah, you got two vehicles. One's gonna be a brand new. One is gonna be a brand new vehicle, so your collision's gonna go right through.
We get new vehicles, we get rid of one, we update the fleet schedule, and they change it as necessary.
But a new car is typically twice as much as a five-year-old car.
Exactly.
It looks to me for like an occurrence, we have $3 million.
Okay.
$1 million on a basic policy and a $2 million umbrella.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was afraid it was more like.
That's really low for the, if we count the police, SCEMS.
Well, they have a separate policy for law enforcement liability.
Okay, good.
Yeah, separate.
How much did we pay for that total policy?
But that's a million.
No, how much did we pay for a premium?
It doesn't show the premiums. Did I see?
Somebody's gotta pay a bill, and we gotta know what the premium is.
That's in this book, but.
That's more, looks like just coverages, just coverages.
$645.
Well, I think as long as we look at it, and I think as long as we look at it and make sure it's high enough.
So for tomorrow.
We budgeted for 5% more than last year. Don't we have that in the? We did, that's right.
But we have $4,000.
Yeah, you have exact.
We had $4,000 last year.
We have $4,000 last year for liability and $200 this year.
Are you talking to SCEMS?
SCEMS.
For SCEMS.
SCEMS, yeah.
Oh, but for general insurance, in fiscal 16, we paid basically $60,000.
For everything.
For general insurance, the town did.
Yeah.
And that was after charging the library for their portion and charging the school for their portion.
Yeah.
And then, of course, writing off what we needed to SCEMS. In fiscal 17, we budgeted $74,000, But if I remember right, we only paid $60,000, which is why we budgeted $65,000 for this coming year.
I think I know why the insurance is low, because you figure those insurance costs in the administrative fee for the town?
It shouldn't even be here.
You do that?
I think so.
No.
No, so those insurance costs should be standalone for the department, and they should be relative to that department.
Correct.
So I think they're low.
So is it okay to leave the $200 in there?
No.
Brenda?
What's that?
Is it okay to leave the $200 in there? They had $4,000 last year.
What's mega property and casualty group insurance?
Yeah.
That is the old company, correct?
It's three.
Right.
Huh, the mega?
I'm talking about the $200.
But that's zero this year.
$200 in which one?
For the liability insurance.
It was moved up under employee benefits.
Last year, we had $4,000.
At the top.
This year, we got $200.
Mega was in workers' comp?
Right, it was the former workman's comp, which is why it's zeroed out this year.
Oh, right, right.
And where is it now?
That was my recommendation based on the fact that.
Up under employee benefits.
Employee benefits.
According to Maya, that's what they gave me for the fee, for $16 for.
For $74,000, or $64,000.
Do you know what your rate is for workers' comp offhand?
And it's only $15.
I get those numbers from.
For SCEMS, that was the only thing that they break out, they said they would break out in SCEMS.
Oh, really?
So you don't know what the rate is?
No.
Usually they rate it so many dollars per thousand.
Yeah, I don't know.
Okay.
Per thousand.
Per hundred.
Of payroll.
Of payroll, right.
So, but it might make sense on that insurance line item to base it on number of employees.
Why?
Or is it general liability includes buildings, is that?
It includes everything.
Well, we don't have a building.
No.
John?
General liability is a suit.
Right.
It's not gonna cover property.
4.7% on gross earnings.
Okay, that's what, yeah.
So, I mean, I.
It's actually a fairly good rate.
Should be an allocation.
It's what it is.
It has a deduction because we participate, there are awards program, we go to state trips and that kind of thing. They reduce it, so different, I just participated. The workers' comp, where's workers' comp? The overall.
That's workers' comp, though.
So we have all our policies.
There should be some allocation anyway. I don't think the town should be paying for all the insurance.
Well, if we're paying $60,000 for insurance, part of that should be shared by SCEMS.
That's what I'm saying.
What percentage, I don't know.
Neither.
And I don't know how they calculate it. And you said you got a basic $1 million policy with a $2 million rider on top of it, so it's a $3 million total liability. And then the question is, how many things do they have covered? How many vehicles do they have covered? How many buildings do they have covered, and stuff like that?
For suits.
It's lawsuits, general liability.
Somebody walks and breaks their ankle out front.
Right, and professional liability is based on.
Well, like, for example, is that $60,000 cover the elementary school?
Pardon?
Does $60,000 cover the elementary school?
It's gonna fall on that liability.
$60,000 is net of what the elementary school paid.
They have their own insurance.
They have their own insurance?
Yes.
Maya breaks it out, what's apportioned to the school.
What, okay, and it's also apportioned out for the library?
For the library as well, yes.
And the senior center?
I don't know if, I can't remember if they apportion the senior center.
Sewer plants?
I just remember the library and the school for sure.
Sewers, sewer plants?
I believe so, but I can't remember on that one.
What else?
Highway garage?
Yeah, but that doesn't get allocated among the towns.
More than.
It would just be more of an internal.
No, the only one that gets allocated amongst the towns are the senior center.
A little bit, I mean.
That's the only one.
Yeah.
And that's only allocated if they put in the budget. They don't put in the budget, then we eat it. Let me ask you about the ALS medications.
Mm-hmm.
You say that the whole lot expires 3 years from the day you get it?
No, that was just an example of
The reason I'm asking that is because a lot of times they find out that medicine's good for 10 and 20 years beyond the expiration date.
Well, you just got done talking about professional insurance. I'm not going to be giving anybody any medication past its expiration date.
So the question is, do they have individual expirations on each medicine?
Not only each medicine vial, but even every Band-Aid, everything on that ambulance has an expiration date on it.
Really?
Yeah.
Is that required by state?
I think it's FDA. I think it's federal. Either way, but when we get inspected, Bonayuto goes through, and he'll reach in, and he'll pull it out, and he'll check the expiration date on it, and he'll gig us for everyone that's even a day over, so.
I thought Phil was trying to help us.
He's stern but fair. Stern but fair.
He's doing his job.
So I got the company answer for the ALS medication. Medical equipment repairs. Fuel, $10,000, $8,000.
Zach, what's a medical equipment? Is that repairs?
Repairs and maintenance, yeah. Okay. So that includes the maintenance contracts for our patient diagnostic equipment, like our cardiac monitors. It also includes just broken equipment, like our stretcher or something, if something happens on a call.
Thank you. Set of tires every year?
I'm not sure how often those tires are swapped out per truck right now. I'd have to talk to David. He does my vehicle maintenance tracking.
What's the travel expense line that's gone from 500 to 2,000?
That is as a result of increased expectation that the individual personnel in the department have to use their personal vehicles to travel in between locations. Once we get into one central location,
where is that?
That number will potentially drop way off. So their duty station is the South Deerfield Fire Department. That's where our crews are headquartered. And in the warmer months, in the summer months, our additional staff or impact shift staff person, who we brought on board last year, that's per diem staff, they would report to Sunderland, pick up the ambulance and drive it back over to the South Deerfield Fire Station and just park it outside all day, secure it outside. But when it's mild temperature, we're required by regulation to keep that vehicle a certain temperature. Now, because they can't park it outside all day long, and the purpose of that impact shift is to free up the full-time staff to perform additional duties, they have to report to the South Deerfield Fire Station and kind of get their marching orders for the day. And when the full-time staff goes out on a call, if there's a high acuity call, they go with them. If they don't need that extra paramedic, that person now has to drive to the other location, the Sunderland Fire Station in this case, pick up the ambulance and man that ambulance so they're ready to go. So it's a little over 7 miles round trip at the 40-cent reimbursement rate. And then we consider the other travel, like just today, I put 30 miles on my car going down to the hospital and back. So as a year wide long, I figured the $2,000 was appropriate if we have to keep shuttling and moving back and forth. Once we get a permanent home, you know, we're going to be right back down to a lower number for the occasional trip.
What's
the
federal?
Like 57,
it's that high now, huh?
Well, the people can't be assigned to that station initially?
The short answer is no. We don't have any offices over there, and they have to report and figure out kind of what their marching orders, what the full-time staff need them to do that day. So that's why they go to...
So they pretty well stay in Deerfield until there's the second call.
Yep, and then they have to, because they have to be available. If that first call requires two paramedics or two staff members to take care of the patient, they have to be immediately available. So they have to be in South Deerfield.
Do you have two paramedics on each call?
Yeah.
The short answer is no. We run a paramedic basic level truck. But when our impact shift, when that per diem, that community member is a paramedic or something like that, then we would have two paramedics available.
And you have three people that day, one is an intermediate or a basic?
At least one person is a paramedic.
At least one person?
At least one person is a paramedic in order to make that a paramedic level truck.
Okay, but then if we have a second call, we need a second paramedic, so.
Correct.
Maybe we'll have two paramedics on during the day, unless it's you.
Yeah, so I do count during Monday through Friday as a second paramedic.
So what we're running during the day is two intermediates and a paramedic plus yourself?
No, it doesn't, it's, our full-time staff, we hired one paramedic and one basic for every shift. Some of those basics have since gone to paramedic school. And that allows us to have two paramedics on a call if a local EMT basic shows up or something like that.
What is a workers' comp contingency?
That's only left over from 2017. That was just because my formula I use for workman's comp was a percentage, and my percentage calculation was coming up higher for fiscal year 17 than the information we were getting from the clerk's office. So we put in a contingency just because we weren't exactly sure what that number was going to be. For FY 18, there is not a workman's comp contingency.
Would you go over the the staffing levels? What do they look like for the entire week? 7 days, 24 hours a day, roughly?
24 hours a day, 7 days a week, we have two people assigned to our primary ambulance, and at least one of them is a paramedic.
And so what time does the day start, basically?
AM shift starts at 7 a.m.
Okay, and it goes to?
3 p.m.
3, okay. So there are two people.
Yep, for our primary ambulance.
Okay, and then from 3 to 11?
Well, the second shift is, for our full-time staff, is 3 p.m. to 7 a.m., but okay. That could be split up into eight-hour blocks if we have per diems or we need to make accommodations for trainings or things
so
like that.
So the 3 o'clock p.m. to 7 a.m., two people?
Correct.
And that's 8 hours of overtime?
No.
No?
Nope, it's overtime after 40. So all the full-time staff only work 40 hours a week.
And what shift does the impact run?
The impact shift runs 10 a.m. to 6 p.m., and that was determined, our busiest times historically, and this is going back through Deerfield EMS, is about 9 a.m. to 9 p.m.
So this is, what were the hours again?
10 a.m. to 6 p.m. So that's an eight-hour shift that is available to local EMTs, paramedics, and our per diem staff to keep them engaged and motivated. And also, we pick those hours because we have people that get up, they work overnight, so it gives them time to get home, shower, and change, and still make it in for work and things like that.
Okay, so that's one person?
That is one person, yep. And that person's job is just to kind of add capacity into the system. So like I said, if there are certain calls that require two people in the back of the ambulance, we have that person during those hours. Or if we get multiple calls during the day, which is happening more and more, that's kind of that additional seed to staff that other ambulance. Either with me as the partner or something like that, so we can have a second ambulance for our busiest calls available immediately, or for extra revenue generation. So when we're doing intercepts to other communities, our policy is that we only provide that service if we can keep an ambulance staffed and available for our community. So during that impact time, when I'm around and that impact person is around, then we're able to do that and get additional revenue that way.
And is that person a paramedic or could be both?
Could be anything, not necessarily. And those shifts are given out somebody help me?
Equitably.
Thank you, everyone. for all of our part-time per diem staff, so we don't pay mine to their level necessarily. We just try to give them out equally.
The 7 to 3 and the 3 to 7, that's one paramedic and at least one.
At least one paramedic to make that a paramedic level truck, yep.
We still have the three levels, basic, intermediate, and
Paramedic, yeah.
How long is that gonna last? When are those?
The intermediate has actually transitioned to advanced, and you will see these three levels basically forever until the advanced EMTs kind of retire. In order to make EMS a career, you have to be a paramedic, and then that EMT basic certification is a semester course. Those extremes will live forever. That advanced is kind of from a bygone era that doesn't really do us any good.
So where does that person fit? Is that at least the equivalent of a basic EMT?
Correct, yeah. So they're able to do some advanced life support skills, but they don't count as far as a paramedic level truck goes.
But they're not equivalent to an intermediate?
It's a little bit higher than an intermediate.
Oh, it is a little higher.
Yeah, they kind of reconfigured what the scope of practice was, but it's generally seen as a higher level than an intermediate.
So where do we place them on the salary schedule?
The same level as intermediate.
Okay.
Yeah, in between a basic and paramedic.
Advanced and intermediate are both the same?
Yes, yeah, and that new class comp that the personnel committee, we changed the name to make sure that it reflected that fact, since those are the certifications people will be carrying.
I was going to ask, Zach, is this with the proposed budget for 2018, is that reflected with a new classification schedule as far as cost?
Yeah, a fair chunk of it. I think the difference I have over 17 is 37,000. 22,000 of that is because of the changes in the classification compensation chart.
Okay.
It does
reflect the new class.
Oh, yes. Yeah. I made sure to give you those numbers,
The reason we asked is because in the classification schedule that we received, we only had two levels, a basic and a paramedic.
Yeah, that's since been corrected, in the latest.
Yeah, they updated
last
night.
No, they have three now.
They did?
Yeah.
And where does that fall?
Step three. Grade three.
How many full-time people do you have?
Nine, including myself.
Zach, does your salary, the director's salary, fall into that classification schedule also?
It does.
So you're a step nine?
Step nine.
No, that hasn't been approved yet. I'm still a step six, I think, this year. I'd have to check.
I'm not sure whether you've been on it for this year.
What's that?
I'm not sure whether or not you were on it for...
Yes, he
was. Was it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a step six on the new schedule. It was grade six. Thank you. Under the new schedule, and it was under the old EMS compensation plan, it was a grade five, but had the same values.
Did that change again?
No.
Grade six. Grade six. Yes. What step?
Let me just. I'll give you an answer. You want to know for FY18 what's being budgeted for? It is budgeted for grade six, step nine is what that's budgeted for.
Yes, I do.
And last year you were 70,000?
No, I was 65,000. For FY...
I don't understand. That's a major discrepancy. That's when we're talking $10,000 increase.
65 would be $13,000
increase in 1 year. I can't believe that we went, that the compensation schedule is that far off.
Well, it's a step that was put on there. Not where he was.
Why does it say 7? Well,
that was what was budgeted for last year, but not what I was.
So your current... 65?
I'm 66 now. I just went up this step. What are we, FY17?
That's a phenomenal increase.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, and those changes were based on my time of hire, annual employee reviews, and performance reviews, which occurred with the step adjustment.
But what you're saying, that those performance reviews provided more than one step increase?
It was the recommendation of the Board of Oversight, yep.
If I jump to capital, is that...
No, are we finished? What we had at, are we finished with the expense fund? Are we looking at that, or we just looking at the overall chart now? I'm not sure where we are in this process, is my problem.
Questions?
I guess question.
Questions all over the place.
Well, there's questions, I understand, but I just like to be able to figure out what we're working off of if I have to take notes here.
Zach, so are you going to have to go to the select board, to the personnel board? You know, I'm just wondering, as far as going from the 66 up to the 78.
That was the recommendation from my Board of Oversight, which I understand goes to the Personnel Committee in Deerfield, since I'm a town of Deerfield employee, and then they hear that, and then...
Okay, so Board of Oversight's coming to a meeting Monday. All right.
Can you explain membership and dues for 5,500? On the back of the page.
Under recertification.
Yeah, that's all right there. Yeah, I know it's all over the place.
Yep, so that's for our full-time staff, for them to maintain their additional certifications in order for them to be employed on the ambulance. So things like CPR cards, advanced cardiac life support, pre-hospital traumatic life support, these are certifications above and beyond the EMT and the paramedic that is required by the state for them to work. And that's just for our full-time staff.
Are they working other jobs as paramedics?
As side jobs? I believe some of them have, yeah.
Any full-time staff that are hired in other towns that are full-time?
I there are some full-time staff that have part-time jobs elsewhere.
My question is the opposite. Is somebody employed by another town full-time and employed part-time by us?
Yes.
And so they receive no benefits from us?
Correct, yeah. They don't get those things paid for. Those are all expected that they're employed.
How many employees are like that?
Well, all of our per diem staff have full-time jobs elsewhere.
Our full-time staff do not have another job, either part-time or full-time.
We do have full-time staff that have per diem jobs elsewhere.
And we're paying for their full certification?
The short answer is yes, because they're full-time staff here and they need to have that for their employment. Yep.
So you're allowing them to, is there a maximum number of hours they can work over and above what they're providing our 40 hours here?
We have policies as far as how much rest they have to get before shifts and things like that.
And who checks that?
Who what?
Who checks that?
Well, ultimately me.
I mean, they tell you that they worked two days ago.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'm on a curling team and I go curling after work too. So, you know, our policies are what they are.
Is there a policy for the director to have one job, or can they have part-time jobs also?
Not that I know of, and that would restrict that.
There's no restriction in your policy?
Not that I'm aware of.
For a salaried employee to work other jobs?
Nope.
I think you become a special employee when you do that in other communities.
I'm going to guess
to file with the.
I don't think that applies to paramedics and.
I think it's elected, isn't it?
Police officers, specials who do that.
It doesn't.
I don't think so.
Okay.
Because I've not seen that happen.
Okay.
Because so many part-time public safety people. Do that.
But
you know, just like
I'm just
you know,
saying a full-time director.
Yeah.
That's salaried.
Right.
Is now working part-time in hypothetical, part-time in one or more communities. It seems like
Well, I'll give you one, just basically, and it may even be two full-time jobs. There is a shift captain in Amherst who is also the, at least department head for the fire, for a fire department.
So he collects two full-time salaries?
Maybe, I don't know, but he's doing a lot of work. You know what I'm talking about?
Is he ever a fire captain in Northampton, was the police chief in West Hampton? He may now be the police, the fire chief in Northampton. Happens all the time in public safety.
Yeah.
So we can look into this.
Because I know, and it very well might be that there are exemptions.
Mm-hmm.
But when I worked for the Housing Authority and was a water commissioner, I was considered a special employee of the town of Deerfield.
Deerfield or Mulberry?
Deerfield.
Okay. I don't know your water commissioner.
Yeah.
Come back.
No.
That's because you're a special.
A special employee.
Yeah.
With no benefits and no pay. No, very little pay.
Welcome to the club.
Is that ever discussed?
Social Security. Okay, thank you.
Do we have other questions on the operational budget?
Yes, I have.
Okay, go ahead.
I have two. This year we're putting in $100,000 in operational reserves. Is this the first year?
That was money set aside out of retained earnings last year and was one of those accounting things where it was kind of lost into retained earnings. So on the recommendation from Joe Markarian was to include it as a line item on the operational budget.
So the money never got put in last year, now you're putting it in this year's, in what?
It's like how our reserve fund
Yeah, I think it's a good idea.
Yeah.
I thought it had happened last year.
No, unfortunately it didn't, so this is the first year.
Okay. The other question that I had was your SCEMS software fees.
Mm-hmm.
To do a 50% increase from last year, like a lot.
But that's because of the employee management software that we've started using. So we
went 15,000
down to five.
Down to five.
Yep.
And what happened last year? We had the software, we weren't using it.
Nope. So originally that 15,000 was a recommendation way back. From what
the 5,000.
Right. So the 5,000 was more reflective of what the cost of our patient care reporting software was. For FY18, we've since added an additional piece of software.
For payroll?
Yes. Yeah, for payroll, for scheduling, for incident reports, things like that. So that's why that increases.
Fine with the town?
Yeah, we haven't set it up. We haven't fully integrated yet, but it's way more transparent and allows us to really drill down and see hours worked and time off and things like that. It's a huge benefit.
Who tracks that with the software? Our, the people in Deerfield office?
No, it's our
so it's
South
taking
SCEMS.
A burden off of our staff.
Is the ultimate plan, yep.
Hopefully.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not fully integrated yet. The plan is that, right, that it'll generate payroll reports that will automatically import, so there won't be double or manual entry in their office anymore.
Time card input.
Correct. None of that anymore is the goal.
Okay.
Yep.
We calculate all the Medicare, all the expenses, all the taxes.
Yeah, that everybody's rates, all the overtime, if there is
Perfect.
Any time off, all that stuff.
I think that'd be great for.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, and it's a huge. Just doing those pay sheets and bringing them over and calculating those, it's a huge headache for us, let alone, I mean, all this effort's being doubled, so it'll be good.
Yeah, good. So next year, you probably look for a reduction
in the
administrative costs.
Hopefully. Yeah.
Do you get annual updates for, like, with the federal withholding tables change? Do you, out of the software, you're going to get that?
Yeah, this is all with the vendor. It's above my pay grade and in cooperation with Barbara's office to make sure that those pieces of software communicate the way they need to.
So are we just going to wait to vote on the enterprise fund portion of the budget?
Well,
we're not going to vote at all.
We're meeting tomorrow with the selectmen, and this will be on the agenda.
Okay, so I'm just asking questions. Both budgets are on hold.
your budget's going in the proper direction.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And that's all I've been saying for a couple of years, that, you know, when you got an excess, when you got a $1.1 million budget, and you have a $500,000 left over, there's a little bit of fluff in there.
Sure, yeah.
And, of course, we knew that, and we knew it through year two, year three, it's starting to get corrected, that's good. So I just want to say, we're moving in the right direction.
Thank you. Nothing makes me happier to have better data and be able to drill these things down and make sure we're.
The one thing that we would really like to see in, is your full-time staff broken out.
I believe you, did you, do you have those? It was a ridiculously small spreadsheet.
I did not.
Okay.
That's fine.
Did not.
I can make copies, I.
The reason we ask is we're on a new comp schedule, and we just want to make sure that everything is working.
It's a comprehensive spreadsheet, and it'll, this is what we've been, I've been using since day one to figure, it has all the full-time employees, their respective rates, their vacation sick time allotments, it breaks out overtime, our estimates for that, and then the backfill necessary with our per diem staff and the impact shift and how many hours.
All we're interested really is, when we look at everybody's budget.
Yeah.
Is full-time staff and what their pay rate is.
Yeah, it's all right there, and she has both, the previous EMS classification plan and the new proposed one, so you'll be able to.
That's why you'd see $17 value paid and what we're asking, what you're asking for in 18. I mean, there isn't, there's $50,000 increase in salaries. And for eight employees, it seems a little high.
Yeah, you'll be able to see exactly.
I'm just saying.
Yeah, some of that, yeah, some of that was, we lost entry-level employees to much better paying, and so, you know, like, we had some personnel shifts, so you can see all that.
Right now, it looks like it's a big number, so just keep it paid.
Yeah, oh, yeah, it's all right there, yeah.
This is the important town meeting right now.
If that's.
Be prepared.
It doesn't include the, like, overtime.
It's fine.
You've got the pay rates.
No, we already got that.
We've got that.
It's simple, oh, you have.
What is important for the public when you go to town meeting is to show why there is a $50,000.
Yeah, right.
And if you have it broken down by, because everybody else in budget has each person in the salary.
Sure, yeah.
For full-time staff, and I think that's important to you.
Yeah, that already exists, so we'll make sure you get a copy of that.
Not that, we don't want a copy.
Okay, we'll make sure it's on hand, yeah.
When you make your presentation, because this budget will be presented at town meeting, is that correct?
Yeah, as long as there's no changes to it.
It'll be presented as an article.
So what needs to be changed is this top salary line.
Yeah, so what you see at town meeting will be a little more abbreviated. It'll show salaries and it'll show other expenses.
Okay, because the question's going to come up, how are eight people getting a $50,000 raise? And that might not be the issue, like you just said.
Right, it might be eight different people.
It is eight different people, but you take eight divided by $50,000 and you're getting a $6,000 raise, or $5,500.
Right. But I think what he was saying.
But that's the explanation.
Less money.
Yeah.
But when we look.
Yeah, I got you.
A point.
In other words, how did you make that number?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
You have to explain this. Somebody's going to ask the question.
Yeah, of course.
Not me. Okay, you want to move the capital?
The capital. I see basically four items in here. We've got the ambulance, and that's reserve, right? That's not any to pay for an existing ambulance, sorry. That's going.
Correct, yes, yep.
That's a two-year.
Yeah.
Makeup. Yeah.
Okay, but so long as, I know what we're talking about, the IV pumps, how often do those get replaced?
Not yet, because that's just brandly.
Skip, here's the regulation.
I said, how often do they get replaced? With the 2015 and 2016, we did not replace pumps then?
We didn't have any. It's just newly mandated by the state. This is, we have to buy our first three. Yeah.
Okay.
And just for your information, as of December 16th, December 15th, 2016, that's when it changed. September 16th, 2016 was the new regulation, and it's updated January 19th, 2017, and it says if you don't have the pumps now, you have to do certain things.
How many pumps are you getting?
Three.
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 One for each truck?
One for each.
That was approved by CIPC.
The short answer, yeah, it's, yeah.
Huh?
What?
The $21,000 approved by CIPC.
Yeah, I agree.
How long do they last? Or like, do they say you gotta have to change them every 5 years or something?
We don't know that, that's gonna be manufacturer's recommendation.
Skip one.
I won't know yet until we know exactly what their operational life expectancy is.
Stretcher load system, I see, that's a stretcher, right? Two stretchers, is that what we're talking about there?
That is that is the thing in the back of the ambulance that, that lifts the stretcher up and picks the wheels up so the employee doesn't have to lift the stretcher anymore.
Okay.
So it's not like a chairlift, it's not something that comes out, you just roll the stretcher onto, lifts the entire stretcher up, and then you push the.
Yeah, it looks like a little yoke thing, and it just kinda.
Oh, so it grabs.
The existing stretcher we have just kinda clicks into it.
Okay.
And then they interface and it picks it up.
And the $50,000, is that for one, for two, for?
The $50,000 is for two.
Okay.
For two.
In those, Zach, as you mentioned before, to the capital improvement committee, those can be transferred from ambulance to ambulance as long as they.
Yeah.
Are functional?
Correct, yeah.
So we won't have to be replacing those.
Exactly, that would move with the stretcher to a new ambulance, yep. Yep.
Why are you only getting two?
The brand new ambulance had one. Yeah, so all three vehicles will be equipped exactly the same safety standard and then one training standard across all units.
So then the next ambulance should be $25,000 cheaper?
Yep.
Yeah, potentially, yeah. Yep, absolutely.
Good point, John.
But they'll go up to that.
Yeah, which I'm sure. Since you paid that last time, yeah.
Get that new stereo radio.
That's right.
So what you took for facilities build out and outing was a balance of retained earnings?
Correct.
Just throw the number there?
Correct.
And whatever you use will have to be approved by capital?
Yeah, this was based on the decision of the Board of Oversight and discussion that, yeah.
I understand the reason, just put it all in there, because then you have zero retained earnings. Because you've already made a reduction in.
In assessments.
Assessments for each town, again, this year.
Correct.
So, but if this, how will this money be spent? And will a financial person from Deerfield oversee the expenditure of these funds? Because some of these things, if they're all lumped together, might have different procurement requirements. I'm just wondering.
Yeah, that's an excellent point, and all I can say is I don't know yet.
Okay, so my solicitations, and you could do best business practices, but you just don't want to get caught buying one thing at a time.
Yeah. Yeah.
You lost me, I guess.
I'm just saying, but Wendy understands it. There's a procurement requirement. Let's say if you had three items, and they were going to be $15,000, but you said, okay, up to 10, you can use best business practice. Well, I'm going to buy two. It's under 10. Mm-hmm. But it really, you should have bought the three together, and you needed to then do a solicitation which included a description of what you wanted. Mm-hmm. And you would have to take the lowest price. You get three solicitations, and you take the lowest price. So between $10,000 and $50,000 is where everything falls.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
So the question is, if you buy carpeting, it's probably going to be best business practice.
Sure. Yeah, I'm familiar with that whole process. I don't know yet how.
You have to run it all through Wendy.
Yeah.
So how did you get the amount of $54,260? So I can tell the capital improvement plan.
It's the balance from the retained earnings.
Did you see it zero at the bottom?
Go to this page.
Well, wait a minute.
Capital expense.
If you see.
Where's the revenue from services and retained earnings, the negative 233,260 come from? You're trying to balance it out.
That's all of the capital items are being paid for out of retained earnings. If you look at the retained earnings, that landscape sheet from before, that 54,260 is just the remaining retained earnings out of that 517,000 that was certified.
So the 233 came out of the 517.
233 came out of the 517, left you a balance. That balance was used to reduce the assessments?
$184,000 was used to reduce the assessments.
184.
284.
Yeah.
Yeah, basically.
284,145 was applied to the operating expenses.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And then. And then we had that, the ambulance replacement fund amount, and then the remainder is going to pay for all of these capital expenses.
So at the end of, you're saying at the end of 2017, the retained earnings is going to be 517,000?
No.
And here's how you're going to appropriate it?
What we had certified.
He's hoping it will be, but it probably will not.
Huh?
What we had certified at the end of fiscal 16 was 517,405.
Yep.
And they're now spending everything that was certified.
So this is the fiscal, okay, this is 2016 retained earnings.
Mm-hmm. And we'll have 17 September, October.
But they still have that cushion in there of operating reserve
what if, like...
That's why they have the operating reserve.
That's a free cash.
Of 100.
That's why they have the operating reserve they bought anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So you're appropriating that, essentially.
So
we're almost done.
When we look at capital items, John, we're taking out this $125,000 of other town funds.
What's that?
On the capital budget.
We talked about that quite a while ago, that we were going to recommend that the capital from EMS would be taken out of their retained earnings.
And right. That's what shows.
Right. That's what he's showing.
That's what
he's showing.
Right.
Right. Yeah.
So your capital budget is less this amount.
Right.
Now.
Yes.
I'm not in there to begin with.
I understand. Well, it was the first time. Okay.
No, our capital budget does not...
Requests.
...does not look at the source of the money.
Understood.
She says, here's the capital we're spending.
That's why I want to make sure...
Stop. And then where the money comes from...
Is up to...
Is not up to the Capital Improvement Planning Committee.
It's up to the selectmen, right? Whoever writes warrant articles.
We just say, yeah, okay, it looks good to spend the money on this.
Perfect.
That's why I have trouble with the 54,260. What are we going to be getting? I mean, from that CIPC?
So yeah, no, I get it. Yeah. 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 And part of it is, at this point, we're even still kind of guessing, you know, what we're going to have
no,
to...
No, CIPC
you don't know.
Haven't brought any money to him. And now you're showing it in your budget. So you need to bring it to him Monday night and say, I have another capital item. Capital item is whatever the dollar value is.
Or tomorrow night.
So if you have time in the meeting.
Well, we can't vote on this, the 54,260.
I know.
Because it's not an item. Sure. We can't approve.
So the issue is, does that stay as retained earnings?
Huh? We're talking CIPC. We're getting away from...
Well, no, I think it's a good question because this $54,000 is good until when? How long can it stay in retained earnings?
Forever.
No.
So forever.
It doesn't have to be aligned.
I mean, if they don't spend it,
stays there forever.
It'll stay retained earnings.
So it rolls over to the next year.
So it does not have to be a line item on this capital budget.
No, it's not. It's really not.
Well, either you designate an amount to be spent out of retained earnings for town meeting,
right.
or you don't. So you can designate it to spend out of retained earnings, but that doesn't mean you have to spend that amount.
But
if you don't spend
it, town meeting does have to approve any expenditure out of retained earnings.
Correct.
So
yes.
It really is the same.
So that's
where
the
catch
22 is.
Mm-hmm. It looks like free cash.
Yeah, it's treated like free cash.
Well, actually, it's not because Tom.
You can't put it on.
You can't put it on the warrant because you have to go to CIPC, and it won't be voted on, and you won't be able to use it.
It does not have to go to CIPC.
It doesn't. CIPC only votes on stuff that's, right, correct me if I'm wrong, Jeff.
You're right.
If only it's gonna be appropriated.
So then the question, then our recommendation is...
Then how do we get around it, right?
No.
How do we get around what?
No, we don't.
Not around it.
It's not...
How do we address it?
It's addressed in a warrant article.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
Right?
It's not gonna be raised through taxes.
That's correct. I understand, that was a discussion we had early on, so it's not an issue.
No, I couldn't say that, but...
According to the bylaw.
But the issue is, if town meeting, there's gonna be a warrant article that says X amount of dollars for building build-out. And it's gonna be the recommended by us and the selectmen, and, but it won't be on capital, won't be a capital item.
Although it should be. There's supposed to be something on the warrant that says the CIPC should look at everything.
Well, that was my point.
No matter where the money's coming from.
That's my point.
But we're not there yet.
Yeah, this accounting issue, because before, when we had these retained earnings, we were earmarking them, and it was up to us to be honest about, you know, where, and so we're trying to just be above board and show it. Yeah, I don't, if it, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
So we can talk about that later.
Sure.
If you want my, I'm gonna throw out a number, $200,000, that's what you're gonna add to retained earnings at the end of this year.
Okay.
Who's SCEMS?
So, yeah, so that's just a guesstimate. See how it looks.
That's based on...
What you're saying is that you think they're gonna have $200,000 instead of $500,000?
Yeah.
Well, they're designating the $500,000.
I'll bet it'll be closer to $300,000 than $200,000.
No, I'm saying at the end of this year, their reserve, their income...
Unexpended funds.
Less expenses will be $200,000. That's really what I'm saying.
And that...
And the simplest fact is that you got roughly $125,000 or $150,000. You're likely to have $125,000 to $150,000 more in income.
Yeah.
So it's not a...
So, but that will still count at the end for under retained earnings.
So, as an example, if they do have $200,000, they can use for capital the $51,000, $57,000 of retained earnings.
Only,
we'll go through the ambulance.
The town meeting has to appropriate. It has to be taken, the town meeting has to vote to take money out of retained earnings. The same as it has to vote...
No, I agree.
To take money out of free cash.
That's, but we're talking that in 17, there's gonna be more money left than expended. There'd be retained earnings. You're saying $200,000, and it won't be certified until the following September.
That's right.
Their profit's gonna be $200,000.
Their profit's gonna be...
Who approves spending out of the reserve fund?
Town meeting.
Of SCEMS?
Town meeting.
That doesn't come through the finance committee?
You got it right here.
So...
So whether we...
It's not approved. We're a recommending body.
Right, we recommend this budget, and it's gonna be broken up into, I believe, specific warrant articles. Or it could be combined.
It'll be a separate warrant article for SCEMS, for the enterprise.
And it'll be broken out, so...
Well, I guess my question is, you have $100,000 in reserves, right, going in reserves right now, that proposed.
No, they don't have any.
Well, somewhere here.
We're putting in, but...
But SCEM operational reserves, $100,000.
For 18, but...
That's something different. And that's what we're talking about.
That's like a reserve fund, if you, for any extraordinary or unforeseen things that might happen, like...
And who appropriates that, is what I'm asking.
That's a good question.
Well, that's part of the budget. That's part of the operating budget.
But who gives a yea or nay on a...
The town meeting.
Even on the reserves?
They're not gonna see those details.
That doesn't come through the finance committee, the way the town reserve...
You've got it right in front of you. This is it.
No, but we're saying when they want to expend it.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, I see.
So what I'm basically asking is, would it be a lot easier to take the $54,000 and put it in the operational reserves as long as there is oversight on spending it, which would come through the finance committees, is what I'm backing out.
There's nothing that I know of in any of the agreements that puts the finance committee in...
No.
Who approves anything coming out of the reserve?
One thing they say is that they're to be considered a part of the town of Deerfield as a separate department.
Right, but if we put $100,000 into the selectman's slush fund, then the selectman could spend it.
Right, well, I think the issue here is there is a person that sits on the SCEMS oversight board from the town as a financial advisor, financial review person.
Financial agent.
Agent is the actual.
Fiscal agent.
Fiscal agent. That person's going to have to approve any expenditures out of that reserve.
No.
Yes.
Why not?
Because they don't approve any expenditure out of it.
Why do we have to approve out of ours?
There's never been any money in it yet.
There's been $1 million in the budget. This is just a piece of the budget. That $100,000 is a piece of the budget, the way I look at it.
But you're calling it reserve.
I think it falls.
Call it whatever you want.
I think enterprise funds have allowed that in, to sit in, you have a capital account and an operating reserve account. Those are two accounts you can set up in enterprise fund. The capital funds approve the town meeting for any expenditures. The operating reserves should be reviewed by the fiscal agent that's overseeing all the budget for the town. And that fiscal agent is our employee.
So who would oversee the wastewater treatment plant should be a fiscal, should be an enterprise fund?
Yes.
But it's not.
Let's assume for the moment that it was.
Yep.
Who oversees expenditures out of the?
Who would?
Yeah, who does now?
Well, it's different. You're saying if they are, who does? Right now, they're not. I'll answer the question, who would be? But okay. I want to answer the question, who does?
Okay, who would be?
Who would be? The fiscal agent of the town.
Who is the fiscal agent of the
Whoever
town?
Whoever the selectman appoint.
It's not an enterprise fund.
If it was an enterprise fund.
But if the fiscal agent, who's the fiscal agent? He's saying there's a fiscal agent that's overseeing SCEMS.
Yes.
Who is that person?
Carolyn Ness.
Carolyn.
Then she's a fiscal agent for the town. She would be the person doing the sewer plant.
Yeah.
Well, on the recommendation of
the select board.
I don't know who picks the select fiscal board. Agent. Huh?
Select board appoints.
I think that's Wendy's job.
Clarification on this.
Which? Want me to be fiscal agent?
Fiscal agent.
No, it's the board appoints, and it was Matt. What was it? It was Dave Wolfram, and then when the board appointed themselves, Carolyn is the, and you
heard. Yeah, when Dave Wolfram was no longer a selectman.
Last week, answer a lot of questions. Yeah. She had the familiarity, she's been around once. Yeah. How should I warn her about tomorrow night's meeting? That's your job. Inform her about being prepared to have this
conversation. Be prepared. It's the Boy Scouts marching song.
Jack, for whatever it's worth, I want to thank you for coming in tonight.
Yeah, yes, great.
Thank you.
You certainly cleared up a lot of items.
Well, I mean that was kind of my goal, is just to like be a translator for what we're looking at.
If you don't know what's going on, you got to have somebody explain it. So thank you for coming in.
My pleasure. I at no time have I ever tried to obfuscate anything. I'm happy that we're getting to a point where I think we're kind of better understanding the enterprise fund.
It takes time.
Yeah, and how we got to account for everything. So thank
Hopefully
you.
Next year will be even easier.
Yeah.
Should be.
Yeah. You'll remember from last year.
We're
building
the track record, right? Yeah.
I have to assume from that last comment that he doesn't know Tom Lehrer. Is it Lehrer?
Tom Lehrer?
Lehrer, yeah.
Yeah.
Obfuscate?
He's too young.
I don't know.
I use that word. He's a smart guy. He uses lots of drinks.
Obfuscate's a perfectly cromulent word. I'm packing up like I'm done.
All right. Thank you.
Tomorrow.
Thank you.
This is the warrants, by the way. Got it in progress.
Thank you.
Thank you, Zach.
You've got almost 4 weeks. Come on. Let's
got posted 4 weeks ahead of time. I'd like you to
What else are we doing?
Can we get a copy of that warrant?
Yeah.
Pardon?
Did you want to go through those other two that you have?
Great, thank you.
We have three, right?
The OPEB, OPEB funding, and the Energy Committee. Was there anything else?
Yeah.
The Energy Committee, that's...
Is that new, again?
The which one?
Interest on maturity debt.
Oh, yes, that one did change.
Okay.
Barbara now has a, an exact figure, interest amount for the school roof project.
$751,900, $5900.
What did I do with that one? Oh, there it is.
Ugh.
Didn't go the right way.
No, no, it didn't. Interest rates went up.
What's changing?
The short-term borrowing interest for the school roof went from $5,700 to $18,750.
When's that going to be paid off and bonded?
Soon, we hope.
Well, I don't know. I think there's question as to whether it will ever be bonded, because we might be able to lower that amount and continue with the short-term borrowing at a lesser cost to the town.
Right, until it increases, it's a variable rate.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You have to watch it.
Some of the customers will.
Right.
Every year.
Where the bonding costs and interest rate to see what we're paying.
So these are all firm numbers, then?
The bonding cost is so...
This is a firm number.
Okay.
Yep.
Make a motion, we make the change to $194,946 on $751,5900.
Second.
Interest on maturing debt.
Okay, we have a motion, we have a second.
Second.
Any further questions on this? I've got a question, but I'll ask it after we vote.
After you vote.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous, 7-0. The question that I have isn't the interest, but if we have this number of 18,750, I have to assume that there's a principal balance that it's calculated from. Can you tell me what it is?
The principal is $1,005,000.
$1,005,000.
Is that a fixed?
$1,005,000 what? $1,005,000 or $1,500,000?
$1,500,000.
And that's it, fixed?
That was what Barbara had borrowed in October for 6 months, and now she's borrowing it again for an entire year.
How's that going to get paid off if
well,
we approve a bond? Well, we just said we're not going to do a bond.
When we see reimbursement from MSBA, then we can lower the amount that we borrow the next time, and we are also getting donations from some of the private schools.
So we anticipate it be less than $1,005,000.
I would think plenty less than, yes.
Mm-hmm.
I'm hoping less than $1,000,000, but you never know.
So how much have we received from...
Not much.
From the school building...
Yeah, like hardly...
I want to say like a couple hundred thousand.
And we had a couple hundred thousand of our own, or 250,000 of our own or something. But didn't we add some to that?
No.
210,000.
We voted to add some to it, but we didn't need to.
We did a very small portion out of the reserve fund, if I remember right.
Yes.
Yes. I couldn't even begin to think what that amount was.
We actually voted a higher amount, and they didn't take it. But I don't remember what.
Okay.
They didn't need it.
They did 80 or 100,000.
I want to say it was less than $4,000, though, wasn't it? I thought it was pretty small.
Our reserve fund?
Then we've got, give or take, $400,000 that's already been paid out from sources other than borrowing.
Will be paid out in the future. Part of it now and parts in the future. We have, I think, $225,000 in promised gifts.
Well, no, but those haven't been paid. So this total project cost us less than $2 million in total? Because I thought
it was
more
pretty
like
close
3.
To $2 million, if I remember right.
Yeah.
In the school,
and the state's going to pay about half of it, roughly.
The school building authority is going to pay 52% of eligible costs, so not 52% of all of it.
All the air conditioning condensers are all in those.
They'll pay for the roofing, but they won't pay for the taking off the air conditioners and putting them back on and replacing them with new ones.
Yeah, those were.
As a rule of thumb, just figure roughly 50% that's close enough for now until we get the final numbers.
Yep.
What's that?
I say just accept the fact that it'll be about 50%, and if we're off by 5 or 10,000, no big deal.
But I'm hoping to be able to do it at some point in time. Start paying down on the principal portion, the word responsible.
Yeah.
Because we've already used up two, you got a 10-year window, as I understand.
Right.
To pay that down. Before we would have to somehow or other borrow the money.
Do we have money sitting in account somewhere, or any money?
Some what money?
Do we have money set aside, or?
Stabilization.
How much? How much is stabilization?
$1.1 million.
And what are we getting for interest income on that?
Probably 0.3%.
So wait a minute, let me finish. All right, what are we paying, what's this, the rate on the school?
1.25, I think.
So why are we saving money at less than 1% and spending?
Because we won't put the money back if we spend it.
Well, I don't think that's fiscally smart.
The problem is we won't do it, that's why you have a stabilization fund.
I think the other question, Brendan, you can ask, could we actually spend that money or use that to offset other expenses without an appropriation?
No, you need an appropriation.
No, I believe it takes we're talking about using money out of the stabilization fund.
Two-thirds.
It takes a two-thirds vote from town meeting.
I understand, but the money's sitting in a checking account. And if somebody wrote a check, would that be illegal?
Well, I don't think it's in an investment, but I don't know that it's in a checking account. She has it in a special fund. And what that interest is that's being earned, that would be a question Barbara could answer for us. But
not a lot, right? Less than what we're paying on the school.
Yes.
Short-term borrowing.
Probably, but I don't know.
Years ago, you could actually
you
make
could
money.
Get to 3%,
right,
yeah.
But so somehow we ought to find a way to manage our money a little better.
It's restricted, that's what I'm trying to say.
The investment side?
Yeah. Well, we can't do anything with money other than investing. We can't use it even though
investors seem to be almost guaranteed.
Yeah. And the school roof wouldn't be a guaranteed investment.
I think, as far as the investing goes and how it can be invested, that would be a question that Barbara could answer. Or Mary.
Mary might have good answers. Oh, sorry to put you on the spot.
Quiet over there.
But when we get a two-thirds vote in town meeting, what happens if we don't get it and we haven't appropriated any money?
Well, if we don't get it, we're right where we are now.
No, we're not. Because
we haven't voted now.
We take this off of the...
Oh, I'm not saying that. I'm not saying change the budget. I'm just saying, as a town, here's what we...
It's something we should look at and get an answer to, and if it's real close, no big deal. Mm-hmm. If it's a major discrepancy,
we might be able to save ourselves.
And use free cash to reimburse stabilization.
Yeah, might save ourselves $15,000.
Or use free cash to pay it off.
So what is the Energy Committee?
It's been in existence for a long time, Energy Resources Committee. They've done many things over the years. They've been managing our Green Communities program. That's a big deal. We just were invited to participate in something through Stan Rosenberg's office. You might have, if you look at our website, there's an announcement of the special program funded by Harold Grinspoon. All the houses in town are being infrared surveyed for energy loss. I tossed that to them to do the communications about that. What?
How are they doing the energy?
There's a group, this is a special project, I started to say. They're driving by, these are MIT, this is a, MIT grad student, not grad students, but a business that grew out of
I think that's a great idea.
I thought they were looking for marijuana on my property.
No, that's the helicopters.
That's the other one.
Anyway, that's okay.
That's the other energy committee.
But I thought that was...
No, but we're going to arrest you for energy loss.
I thought we were one of the three towns that received this as a free product.
Yes.
So we're paying... The energy committee needs money.
This is money for them to then do the follow-up. We got the testing for free.
So we'll get data.
Mailings, yeah, and we'll get, we can get information on.
So each somebody, the energy committee's going to tell me that I'm using lights at night? Is that, they're going to send me a letter?
It will be a whole report on what the energy was.
It will be, they're, so.
Yes, I don't know exactly yet because I keep asking for more detailed information. I will ask them to give me more info because I know.
Why is the energy committee doing it?
Why?
Yeah, why are they sending out personal information?
They're not. It'll, it would, you know, they're just, I invited them and Kip when I was called by Senator Rosenberg's office to be a special, one of the three towns in this Hampshire County in his district, to four towns, Northampton, Greenfield. We were the only town, the three cities and us, Greenfield, Northampton, and Amherst and Deerfield were invited to be part of this. And the project of the scanning is no cost. That's what they're underwriting. I don't know what they're going to give. It's not clear they're going to give us anything for informational brochures beyond the initial data. And this is they want to do, the committee that exists now, it's all different people than when I was previously here. It's a great interest in doing work around energy, information, education, that kind of thing, and that's what they recently submitted.
Kip, I make a motion we approve the $1,000 budget for energy.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there a second? Okay, so it's.
I can try to get more information for tomorrow night if you'd like.
Motion been made, seconded. Question. The select board looked at this?
Kip has.
Which the test?
Energy committee.
The energy
committee. It just came in.
The appropriation.
I think I just got it.
Yeah, we just got it from them yesterday, I think.
Myself, I think I'd like more information before I voted it.
Me too.
Didn't you already vote?
No.
No, we just.
They got a second on the table. We can vote.
We got a motion, but not a vote.
Any further questions? We're going to take a vote.
Did they state why they needed $1,000?
No.
For flyers.
Yeah.
Produce flyers.
Literature, postage.
So
there's no expense to the.
Somebody has to put it together to mail it.
They'll do. They'll.
Going to use a drone to deliver it? They're going to drop it? How are they going to do this?
No postage.
We don't even know what we're getting.
We're going to support the U.S. Postal Service.
We don't even know what we're getting for data, whether it's going to be distinguishable between, it's going to be raw data potentially, and it might not be house specific.
It is going to be house specific. It's going to be house specific.
So they're going to have 2,500.
It's all good.
Yeah, I thought it was going to be limited to a certain area, but apparently they do again. We have
said like
that at the last meeting.
It seems like it should stay in a public entity, not in a committee. That's my feeling. I don't think we should have committee members sending personal information out to residents. This is personal information. We're allowing it to happen. They're taking an energy audit on everybody's house that they can actually do one on. And then we're allowing the energy committee to have those results and send a flyer and the data to the homeowner.
What's being sent to the homeowner is not a request that they be allowed to do.
Let me clarify this information. I hear what you're saying, and
yeah,
I will clarify
it's
this.
It's an infringement on my rights.
I think if you have a committee, and the committee has a charge to try and save energy for the town, and they're doing it, to have a budget which they've never had before and start a budget for $1,000, whether they use it or not, that's beside the point. You've got to give them a fair shot to at least have money available in case they need it.
Like mosquitoes.
That's what this is for.
Well, if it's not for this specific topic we're discussing, I might vote for it.
My understanding is for other things that they want to do. I'm sorry, I just can't tell you what those other things are right now. Well, but I will try my best to find out tomorrow.
I don't think they're going to take personal information. I think you're going to find,
yeah,
if they do a flyover.
They're not. They're doing it by car.
By car.
They do it by car.
Yeah. I'll say a little more about the meeting because I was there. There were. Actually, those three cities have people whose full-time jobs is energy work for the city. And Carol, I think her name is Carol Collins, anyway, who is the person in Greenfield, had done this program before. And I'm aware of it having been done in Hampden County. It wasn't so very successful. And these folks are all real knowledgeable about the work in this field, and there was a presentation that was a bit technically beyond me, but they were very impressed with it and the kind of data and the kind of explanation they had and answers to questions. So they're all very excited about it, and they think this is a major steps above previous kinds of infrared technologies and information gathering. As far as the privacy stuff, I actually thought that they would send, you know, we would ask people first, but we sort that out. No, I do believe there was privacy protection. I would like that information as well, so I'll do what I can to have that for you tomorrow night.
Who ultimately owns all this data? Because there again, as Bruce says, what you're going to see is somewhere down the road, the realtor's going to get a hold of it, the insurance company's going to get a hold of it, and
we might pass a bylaw saying that you need authority in the walls and make it retroactive.
Well, how does this? How do you do like assessor's records? Don't you also have a lot of personal information? It's now public. And
well,
everything's public now. I get requests public, but at least every 20 minutes.
But I mean, you know, a good example is the insurance companies have all banded together now, and a lot of states around here. If there had been one claim on the house in past history, a new owner better beware when he goes to purchase house insurance, because that goes a lot right along with the house. And is this going to be a black mark on the house if it has a poor energy evaluation?
Mm-hmm. Right. And I thought Eversource provided energy audits for homes and that.
So, kind of meager stuff.
I mean, once again, are we duplicating something here?
Yeah.
It seems.
No. Let me talk.
Sometimes when we get something for nothing, it ends up costing us money.
Well, let me tell you.
To start off with, and then it continues to grow too.
And
I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm just saying that, you know, here we are once again. Are we going to duplicate something? That's all I'm concerned about also,
okay.
Besides the
You are reminding issue. Me of something else that was said during this meeting, which was weeks ago now, was that Senator Rosenberg was very interested in this because as where he sits in Boston, the utility companies get the money to do these energy savings programs that they contract out with others, and they don't know if they're effective or not. And they're looking at, one of the reasons why he was so interested in this, because he was very impressed by the technology and other experts he had around. So they want to see if this is a better way to go and whether they should spend money on this kind of program. So this is a bit of a pilot and a prototype for something.
So can they tell whether we're using LED lights or incandescent lights?
I don't know. I'm writing that down.
So that would be part of the
move the question.
Question move.
Voted either up or down.
I'm
send,
ready.
Send me an email with any questions you might have. Quickly.
They want to kill something, you got OPEB funding it, which is next.
Right.
That's
on, it's on the radar. On the
which way do we get there? Because I want to discuss that.
What's the vote?
We got a motion on the table, right?
Is there any further discussion?
No.
No?
No, I don't have any further discussion.
Okay. All those in favor of the motion?
Aye. That's Energy Committee, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, raise your hand so I can count.
And I just want to call out to the Energy Committee, if any of you are listening, please give me a call.
any, who's, all those who are opposed?
One, two, three, four. Does not count.
Does not carry.
Okay.
What's next?
Okay. The next one.
It's up to you.
OPEB funding.
My question on that is,
this a German on my mind. really
this is to pay. This is to set aside money for people that are going to leave.
No.
In the future.
No.
Their retirement benefits. Their post.
Just insurance.
No,
just
benefits.
Medical insurance.
That's OPEB.
It's medical insurance only.
Other people.
This is for
our
health
benefits.
Insurance. All right. Do we have in our budget, in other sheets, health insurance?
Yes.
Yes.
Does it include people that have retired?
Yes.
Then we're doubling up.
But
no,
you're
going to
have more people.
No. This is for the people who are working now.
Mary
so
knows
when they
this.
Retire, they'll have funding to help pay for their insurance.
But won't we include that in the next budget?
When we do that budget, yeah. I mean, why?
We're not budgeting.
We're
budgeting for health insurance.
Mary can speak
Mary,
to this.
Budgeting for the future cost of health insurance for the current employees.
I understand that, but we currently, like John said.
Would you let Mary try to explain what OPEB is?
I'd be glad to.
OPEB is a fund to, that's created to pay for future retirees. And what they do is, we have a liability already set up for OPEB, which is in the millions, right? And this is basically our start of building up the fund for retirement benefits.
Question?
For health, retired, health benefits for retirees.
So if John is correct, and we include funding for retired employees' health insurance, what is the difference in the two programs?
What, this is really an accounting.
Well, let me ask it this, excuse me, let me ask it this way.
It is, it is.
Let me, I know, it's the point on our balance. What do we do with the money that, the health insurance money that we set aside in our budget? Do we actually pay their health insurance, correct?
We pay for it.
Percentage.
Percentage of health, right.
What, we pay for.
The retirees.
I'm retired.
Me too.
So the town of Greenfield pays for whatever they pay for this year.
Yep.
The accounting board, general accounting board.
GASB 45.
Says.
That's it.
And they've done it for private corporations, and they're saying you really need to do it in the public sector. While the employee is on your payroll, you need to set aside money to cover the cost of his future benefits, his or hers, so that when he retires or she retires, you no longer will be paying into. That's the.
They're not saying you have to set aside money. They're saying you have a liability.
They do say you should set aside money.
No, that's not what GASB 45 says. Doesn't say, can I finish?
I think Barb says you can draw from this if you have to, right?
It just says you have a liability that in the future will have to be paid. Doesn't say you have to set the money aside.
And that's what we currently do.
Now, what the state is saying, we have to, as a town, have to do, I don't know. I was talking to the accountant.
The state has not determined what should be done. As a matter of fact, at the Council of Government, what they, we happen to have an OPEB account set up only because we had extra cash left over, and there's a different accounting system for the county, and we rolled that over into the OPEB account. However, our OPEB liability here is somewhere around $2 million. What the state has recommended, last that I knew, was you wait until you finish paying off for the increased premiums we're paying now to get our retirement insurance account into effect, into total compliance, which is scheduled for 2033. When you finish that, then you start funding this. So I'm not going to vote for this only because I think this is premature to do it. If we do it, we'll probably be the only town in Franklin County that's doing it. And it's fine if you got money to blow, but I don't see this year as having us that much money that we can afford to blow.
You and I agree. And it's also in, elsewhere in the budget.
That's why I said you got bigger.
Could I ask that you let Mary, because she's, she was here when we had the actuarial studies done and.
Yeah, the actuarial study says that we will.
We just had another one done this year.
We'll owe millions of dollars. The state has recommended that we start building an open.
This is a small amount of money.
We can actually draw on this if we, according to Barb, what Barb told me, the newest thing is you can draw on this account if we get to a point where we can't afford our retirees. We've got some money put aside for that.
So it's like a stabilization.
It's like a stabilization, but it's not what they call it.
I actually have it on the warrant with council reviewing it because there's a option to set up a trust fund, and I don't know if that's.
The what?
A trust fund, and I don't know if that means it. I'll get back
it's
to
building.
You on this. I don't want to conjecture.
Yeah. Just to get this thing over with, I'd like to make a motion that we authorize OPEB funding for $20,000.
I thought you were against it.
I am, but I'm going to get it on the table so I can vote against it and go home.
Why don't you just make a motion that we don't?
Well, we need us. We got to, no.
I think we should be positive, and if they've got a funding thing in here, I think we should try to fund it. And if nobody wants to, I don't want to do it personally.
It's been moved and seconded.
Who seconded it?
Any further?
I did.
Mary did. Any further discussion? I've got some. So we talked earlier, and the last I had heard, the number was $10,000
right.
That we were
So I'm going to move.
We actually,
that was a mistake. 13 to 14.
Spend between 13,000 and 14,000 a year right now for the retirees.
But it's in the budget. It's already in the other sheets.
The current amount, yes.
But when all you retire in the early, not too distant.
Be careful.
Not too distant future.
You're going to get retirement.
It's going to be our generation with a huge bill to pay.
But understand.
It's nice to put money now aside, but as I'm sitting around 20 years from now, I'm going to be paying all you guys to be retired in Florida.
It's your generation that this is supposed to cover.
I know, all of it. We got to cover it.
And this liability.
I knew. I just got my tax bill.
This liability is reflected in our audited financial statements every year.
Right.
It's only going to grow if we don't show a good faith effort towards funding at least a small portion of it, the way I understand it.
Yeah.
Barbara went to a meeting about all of this a few days ago and learned a lot more. And she could probably speak to it better, but.
But it is for the future.
Good.
From what I gathered, so there's this new legislation, they revamped this whole OPEB and so forth as far as, a lot of questions that came up last year was who's going to handle it, how it's going to be funded, how it's going to be operated and everything else. So where would this $20,000, if it was appropriated, go? To what fund? The state managed fund?
Or stay here.
The town managed fund?
Yeah.
We'll invest it at less than 1%.
We'll get more information on that as well.
There are firms that manage the money for you.
I was willing to do $10,000. I'm not willing to.
That was my mistake because I thought I had heard 10 and then.
I heard two, so.
It's fine. I like 10.
A good faith effort to start.
Better than nothing.
Why don't you call the question when we vote it down? You can make another motion for 10.
Call the question. I will do that. See if we. All right. If there are no further discussion.
Can we change it to $10,000?
You can make an amendment to the motion.
You know, let's just vote it. It's going to get voted down. All those in favor of the $20,000, please say aye. All those opposed?
Nay.
Aye.
Nay.
Nay.
I make a motion, we put $10,000 in there.
I'll second it. Okay. Do we need any more discussion? Do you want to know what the $10,000 is for? Okay. What are your thoughts on 10?
I don't think we should put anything in.
I don't think we should put anything in.
Okay. What do you think?
Should we stop doing actuarial studies if we're.
They're still playing with it, the state house with the.
All right. All those in favor of $10,000, please say aye.
Aye.
Did you say aye, Mary?
Yes.
So that's three. You said aye.
Yeah, three.
That's three.
Let's have another here, folks.
All those in favor, all those opposed.
75-50.
Nay.
So that's four. So let's.
Same vote.
Dead horse.
Same vote.
Dead horse.
So I said, let's get this over and done with.
It's only rec, this is only a recommendation.
The lack thereof.
I just love your support, you know, here for your support.
We'll take care of you, Trevor.
All right. As long as you're around when I'm going to need it.
Thanks a lot.
So.
Do we have a number on this?
What?
On the OPEB funding? No, just an article.
If we ever did it.
Let's see. I was going to talk about the acquisition or of the church, but it's too late, so.
Well, can I just add one? Oh, go ahead.
But it's too late. We've been here for 2.5 hours. That's, or 2 hours and 20 minutes. That's 20 minutes over my.
You're not going to be here tomorrow. What?
No, Peg. So just so you know, you will see a change in the contracted services budget, but we're waiting for a number. This fiscal year, we received $50,000 in regards to our PEG access funds.
Capital fund.
Specifically earmarked for capital acquisitions for FCAT, for the work that they do here. It went into the general fund, but we have a responsibility to use that specifically for capital items. The manager of FCAT is trying to work up some numbers of things that he needs to have in his system to help us do a better job of reporting our meetings. And is coming together with a list for us of specific things that he wants to purchase. It's probably going to be less than the $50,000, but we still have a responsibility to use $50,000 towards that at some point. So he would like to use some of that this year, probably some of it next year, so on and so forth.
Can you come up with something so that you can just encumber the funds?
Be ideal if you could.
Okay.
But you'd have to have an invoice. It'd have to have an invoice.
Or whatever.
Like a budget for $50,000, and then he spends whatever he can.
Well, that's what I asked him to do, is a capital plan, because it's a 10-year license agreement, a 10-year capital payout.
And if he doesn't know what he needs, then he capital plan.
Well, he has a good idea. He just needs to have a little bit of time the rest of this week to come up with the costs.
Yeah. But then, you know, just come up with $50,000 in materials to cover what we already voted. We did vote, at some points we voted that money for the.
No, we didn't vote any of that money yet.
Not yet.
Okay.
Did we already get the $50,000?
We have received it. It's in our bank account.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we do need to vote some, or somebody needs to budget something.
Right.
Okay. We're going to put it in contracted services.
It'll be an article to do that, right?
No, it'll be in contracted services.
We'll just put it into contracted services.
That throws contracted services all wrong. Can we do a separate article? Because, you know, we'll see.
We could put it into the data processing IT line that we were going to put it in, or that we were thinking about.
Right, we'll put it back in there. Okay.
We ought to do a separate thing if we can. A separate line item.
You want a separate article for it?
Separate line item.
Yeah, within our omnibus budget.
And that way we can keep track of how much money we got and how much we spent.
Okay.
That's a simple way to take care of it.
I will make that happen.
What I get worried about is 2 years from now, we'll see this thing.
You won't remember, yeah.
That is another budget we'll have to approve that'll affect our bottom line, yes.
Are you ready for motion to adjourn?
I am.
Except it's not appropriate.
Where are we meeting tomorrow night?
I mean, it's not raised, it's just.
6:30.
We're meeting here?
Turnaround, Ronnie. Okay.
Where? In the police department?
Police department.
Yep.
Okay.
No, that is what they said.
Okay.
They switched.
Every room is being used.
Every room?
All those in favor of adjourning?
No, that's yours. You're one of the users.
All those opposed? It's unanimous. We're adjourned.
Wendy, have they started putting together the warrant for the annual town meeting?
That's what I said. I've got that. I'm going back and forth with council.